to make it sound less mouthful. That actually means I love studying, to the detriment of my students. I'd like to start this evening out to say, my son is scared of the dark. So when dusk falls, he looks around and tries to seek some company of those who can comfort him. And it always ends up with mommy dragging me by the hand to his bedroom. Story time, because we all know he's scared to go sleep alone. So mommy will lie there and we will do all these wonderful stories. And eventually, his breathing will slow down, he'll fall asleep, he'll cuddle up, and I can hear he's gone. He's safe, mommy is there. And that's how we do it. We empower the men. We start So now I want to complain about women being empowered. You should go back home. I am a mom. I'm a chemical engineer. I'm a patent attorney. I'm a lecturer. I'm an editor. I'm an author. I'm a counselor. I'm lots of things. And it's in this variety that I think innovation is great. Because if you're not busy all the time, you get a little bored. And innovation is difficult where there's boredom. It's important for women to be involved in technology, to understand what it's about, to be involved in businesses, whether you are innovating and finding a different way of cleaning the dustbin for the seventh time, or finding an innovative way of making the men put the toilet seat down, or being there to cook something really wonderful so that your child will eat it by making funny faces on the plate. Innovation is not just about creating very amazing, wonderful technologies. It's about making an interesting environment where you live, creating and making opportunities for those who do not have them. My motto in life is, you are never too good to do anything or to try anything. When I get to where I thought I wanted to be, it's never the end. It's only the beginning. I always go, I think Sadula often asks me, what energizes you? Do you take something? No, I don't. I'm energized by being busy at all the times. So I've always studied, when you listen to my qualifications background, I've always studied different things. When transfer pricing came in tax law, and when was it? I can't even remember, many years ago. I had to study this for work, and I thought, why do I waste the energy in reading through this? I may as well do something valuable and get a qualification for it. So I did. Came around intellectual property at Sasol, and I started out in Mintec. It was a male-dominant world. They stuck me in the pyrometallurgical division. I was dirty most of the time, and there were no ladies' rooms, only men's rooms. And I was, when I had a shower, they would normally hide my clothes away. So when I get out, I had to run around in a towel, finding my clothes, my shoes, and everything being hidden away. So I hated it. I hated being an engineer. And then I decided to start studying intellectual property law, because I was told that patent attorneys at least have a future. You don't have to be stuck in the engineering environment. So it happens that some guy from Australia came. In the last few months, I was deciding to get back into law. And he became such a wonderful mentor that I didn't want to leave engineering. And at that same time, I was offered a job by Sasol as a process engineer in the R&D department, having to work in a male-dominant environment. I thought, well, that's a great opportunity. Let's go and show them we can do this. While I was working at Sasol, we were in the Fischer-Tropsch technology, and we had great difficulty fighting against patents of ExxonMobil and Shell. And I realized, well, we don't have an intellectual property department. We need to do something about this. And I was a very young engineer, and we had these inventions where all the engineers, the young and upcoming engineers, are invited to meet the CEO of the company, and all the managing directors of all the business departments will be there. And I thought, tonight is the night I'm going to start this intellectual property department. So everybody said, oh, forget it, some other guys have tried before. I said, I haven't tried before. You never know what the answer is going to be if you don't ask. So I go, walk up to the CEO and said, I think you need an intellectual property department, and I think I'll start it for you. And he looked at me and he says, come see me in my office. I said, does that mean go away? You're not going to think about it? He says, no, come see me in my office. So I went there the next day. Lo and behold, 3 months later, I was doing my articles at Adams & Adams on an engineering exchange program on an engineering salary. How's that for innovation? I did my articles in a year period. We did the night school, the Law Society offers a 6 months night school where you can shorten your article period from 2 years to a year. But then we had Judge van Dijkhorst, who decided that evening school is not full-time school, and therefore it doesn't count to cut off a year of your articles. So we decided to make it, do something more, to start another innovation project, to challenge the judge. So we brought an application, the court was back, and we won the case, because we spent more hours in the classroom than the full day students. So we got the year off. A year later, I was back at task when I started the intellectual property department. I didn't know a thing. I was so scared, but I didn't tell anyone. So I had a very wonderful mentor at Anton, which was Gavin Kotzer, who was my principal, and I spent many hours on the phone with him, helping me through the scary moments. But I never let anybody know how scared I was. Because what shows here and what goes on here should never meet each other. Every time I have to make a public speech, every evening I stand up in front of my classroom on a Wednesday evening when I lecture my students, I'm scared. I'm always scared. I always feel that tingle in my body and in my heart and the flutters of butterflies in my stomach. Because I think if that will go away, the innovation will go away, the creativity will go away. If you get complacent about who you are and what you do and what you can accomplish, you won't accomplish any of that. You won't go anywhere. You can make a difference as a woman, as a person. You can make that difference and you can decide what it is to be. You make your own destiny. I want to end up with something that I found, of course, by a woman, a British novelist, J.K. Rowling. She says, "We do not need magic to change the world. We carry all the power we need inside ourselves already. We have the power to imagine better." I thought a few years ago, when I left Tassel, I came to Stellenbosch, that I'm going to slow down, raise my family, because I didn't want to raise my kids in Johannesburg. And then I met Owen Dean, who changed all of that, dragged me back into the academics. But slowly over time, I realized that I'm not the slow down type. I will never slow down. I will fill the gaps there is with something more and something interesting. So now I write, I edit, I create, but I'm still a mom. And for me, the most important thing for any woman is to realize that you have to have a balance. You have to challenge, you have to be out there and do everything, but you have to remain inside yourself, always who you are. Never forget who you are, because that makes you who you want to be. And you can set an example for others to show the energy that you possess to innovate and empower yourself and those around you.